Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. It's time for this month's Q&A, but first, let's get high on tea. This week's tea is Anhua Dark Tea. Anhua is a county in Yiyang City, Hunan Province. This region has more than 1,000 years worth of tea growing history. Hei means black or dark. Cha means tea. So, the name in English is Anhua Black Tea. However, in the West, many people call it Anhua Dark Tea. There are many different types of Anhua Dark Teas depending on the source of tea leaf, processing method, and so on. Today, I'd like to introduce Fu Cha, a very popular Anhua Hei Cha. To make it easier to understand and memorize, let's call it Fu Cha. There are different versions of the name Fu Cha. Some people say that this tea was originally from Hunan province, and the local people of Hunan pronounced the first character of Hu as Fu in their local dialect. So, the tea or Cha made in Fu came to be called Fu Cha. According to another popular version, it is believed that this tea is produced during the hottest days in summer, called Fu Tian or Fu Season in Chinese. So, tea or Cha produced in the Fu Season is called Fu Cha. Of course, there are many other origin stories as well, but in the interest of time, let's move on. So, what is the unique benefit of Fu Cha? To answer this question, I have to first tell you that besides other benefits provided by many other teas, the unique benefit of Fu Cha is due to Jin Hua or golden flower, which is a type of probiotic fungus. If you break a Fu Cha cake and look at the inside of the cake, you can see the small yellow spots. That is what the golden flowers and the fungus look like. The name of the golden flower is Guan Tu San Nang Jun or Eurotitum Chrysanthemum. Originally, this fungus was used to enhance tea quality through fermentation. This fungus is non-toxic and safe for food fermentation. To cultivate this fungus, certain temperatures and humidity are critical. Eurotitum chrysanthemum, or the golden flower in Fu Cha, is known to reduce obesity, regulates the blood lipid balance and cholesterol metabolism, enhance immunity and modulate gut microbiota, among other benefits. Fu Cha is strong and available in flowery, pine trees and other flavors. At home, I have quite a few varieties of Fu Cha based on flavor and age. This one is my favorite because of the nice color of its decoction and its strong pine tree flavor. To brew Fu Cha, the water temperature should be 100 degrees Celsius. Normally, we add hot water for a few seconds to the teapot already containing tea leaves, and then throw the water away in order to make sure the tea is clean. This step is called Xi Cha or washing the tea. Then you are ready to brew the tea. Normally, 10 seconds of brewing time is ideal for the first brew. Then reduce brewing time by a few seconds from the second to about the sixth brew, since tea is strong before the sixth brew. Then Add a few seconds for each subsequent brew. By the way, the golden flower or Urotitum cristatum, the healthy fungus itself, is the reason behind the unique flavor of Fu Cha. Fu Cha has about 600 years worth of history, but has been rapid growth in popularity in the last 10 years. In contrast to other teas that I have introduced previously, people drink Fu Cha mainly for health benefits rather than its flavor. I recommend you all try this tea, and I'm sure you will fall in love with it. Feel free to share your experience with Fu Cha or any other tea in the comments section. Now, let's take a quick look at questions for today. First, Kim Baggis, Tai Chi practice and Dan Tian power. Second, Aaron Buddha, leaning motion in Wu style Tai Chi. Third, Zhuang Otakrin, Lao San Quan. Fourth, Frederick Godin, Xing Yi 8 words. Fifth, Frederick Godin, Xing Yi elbow techniques. Sixth, Frederick Godin, Pesticide in tea. Seventh, Friedrich Axtis. Third, Xiu Dao self study. Friedrich August III, simplified versus traditional Hanzi. Ninth, unknown 963, Xiu Dao practice and risks. Tenth, Stephen Ambrosik, Xiu Dao 9 years practice. So, let's get started. Kim Baggers asked an interesting Tai Chi question. So I'd like to read his question first. He said, quote, "In order to do Tai Chi well, it's true you have to have a well-developed Dan Tian such that no part is lacking in internal pressure so the waist can turn fully in the form. But how do you develop internal pressure without using the form instead of using breathing intent, etc., to feel or pressurize a part of the abdomen that is lacking in internal pressure, i.e. using a static method such as Zhanzhuang or any other that you might be familiar with to achieve this goal?" End quote. Thank you for the question, Ken. Short answer, it depends. First of all, let's clarify what Dan Tian is. In martial art practice, Dan Tian is the lower abdomen area. More specifically, it is a physical area where a certain type of martial power can be generated in practice. Bear in mind that it is a physical area that can be used to generate some martial power, but not all. In Chinese martial arts, martial power generated by Dan Tian practice is called Dan Tian Jin or Dan Tian power. Dan Tian power is important, but it cannot represent all types of martial powers. Developing Dan Tian power is not based only on internal pressure. More importantly, it is the mechanism of body movement that can optimize power generation. So, any practice that can improve flexibility, strength, and coordination with other body parts are parts of Dan Tian training. So, to answer your question, Dan Tian power is not about feeling or increasing its pressure in training, but involves many other essential practices. As for Zhanzhuang, the static method cannot help you achieve Dan Tian power, since static training can only help with relaxation, which only has the indirect impact on Dan Tian training. However, if you add some subtle movements to Zhanzhuang, then the nature of a 站桩 won't be the same anymore. Some styles, such as 一拳, still call it 站桩. In that case, it can be used to practice power generation. Furthermore, breathing and intent are all parts of any Tai Chi form training, meaning that a good Tai Chi practitioner should not separate physical movements from breathing or intent, since they are both parts of the system. By the way, I recommend you watch my video titled Dan Tian, The Source of Internal Strength Explained, which explains the different meanings of Dan Tian in different practices. Link is in the description.I hope that answers the question, Ken. Let's move on to the next one. Iron Buddha asked me a question about the leaning motion in Wu style Tai Chi. Thank you for the question, Iron Buddha. First of all, I have to let you know that I do not practice Wu style Tai Chi. However, since I mainly practice Chen style Tai Chi,I'd like to answer this question based on my Tai Chi practice experience. No matter what style of Tai Chi, 斜中预正 is one of the important concepts to handle leaning motion and posture. Based on my observation, Wu style Tai Chi emphasized the 斜中预正 concept the most compared to other style of Tai Chi. So,It is important to understand the term 斜中预正. I recommend watching my video titled Internal Style Concept 50, Straightness in Leaning Motion, 斜中预正, in which I have explained this concept in detail. Link is in the description. I believe that video should answer your questions. I hope that helps, Iron Buddha. Let's move on to the next one.John O. Tankun asks, quote, May I request a video on Lao San Quan? I have heard that they include Zuan Guo Jian, but would like to learn more about how they related to the rise of the Xing Yi Quan, end quote. Thank you, John. This is a very good question. Lao San Quan, or Old Three Fists, or Zuan Guo Jian,Three verbs used to name each action and principle is one of the most important practices of Dai family Xing Yi without a G. Xing Yi with a G developed upon Dai family Xing Yi, and as a part of this development, the Zuan Guo Jian, aka Lao San Quan or Old Three Fists,was integrated into Xing Yi's five elements. So, the five elements replaced the old three fists in Xing Yi practice. Of course, there are other explanations as well, but in my opinion and experience, this version is the most technically sound and consistent. So, Lao San Quan is the termused in Dai family Xing Yi, but Xing Yi used the five elements fist. John, I hope I have answered your question. Thank you for asking. Federico Golden asked four very interesting questions, and I'd like to answer three of them today. The first one on Tai Chi kicking will be answered in the future in a dedicated video. First,He asked about the eight words of the Xing Yi, 八字 or eight words, which include 斩截果胯挑顶云岭 are eight Xing Yi techniques aimed at improving Xing Yi combat skills. There is a popular Xing Yi proverb, 五行为法，十二行为体，八字功为用. Translation, five elements is the principle,Twelve animals is the substance, and eight words is the function. End translation. Technically, eight words is taught after students master the five elements and the 12 animal practices. which indicates that it is an advanced practice in Xingyi. Long story short, 8 words is simply 8 techniques focusing on Xingyi application of compact techniques. Next, he asked, quote, Xingyi elbow strikes techniques seem more seldom than first full elbow striking Xingyi routines. Is it possible to list a few elbow strike types from Xingyi? For instance, are there straight strikes of type up to down, down to up, horizontal, etc.? Additionally, are they all found in some routine forms? End quote. Well, in Xingyi, there are many elbow striking techniques. For example, bear, rooster, monkey, horse, and many other animal forms have elbow striking techniques. However, if we have to categorize all the elbow striking techniques, we can use the direction of force as the criterion. So, elbow strikes can be directed forward, backward, upward, downward, sideways, diagonal, and so on. I prefer to analyze elbow striking techniques within the context of the routine or form, and not in isolation. Finally, he asked about the usage of pesticides in the process of tea cultivation, and any specific pre-treatments to mitigate their harmful effects. Yes, the effect of a pesticide are a major concern when drinking tea. Some tea farmers use pesticides for pest control on their tea plantations. Of course, growing tea without using any pesticide is ideal. But you have to know a few things here. First, most pesticides used for tea trees are oil-based, which can't be easily washed away with water. The good news is that if you do not brew the tea for a very long time, then pesticide will most likely remain on the tea leaf itself and not enter the decoction. Second, to my knowledge, the quantity of pesticides used in tea plantation is usually within the safety limits. And third, many tea trees do not need any pesticides, such as trees used for producing pu'er herb teas and some other big leaf teas. Having said that, I'd like to provide 3 solutions to mitigate the effects of pesticide. First, buy tea from reputable suppliers. Second, buy pesticide-free teas such as pu'er herb tea. Third, do not brew tea for a very long time. For example, do not drink tea brewed overnight. These 3 solutions will go a very long way in avoiding any potential health issues due to pesticides used in tea. Fred, I hope I have answered your questions. Let's move on to the next one. Frederick, August 3rd, asked 2 questions about Xiu Dao. His first question is about the possibility to practice Xiu Dao by self-study and online resources if direct learning from a teacher is difficult to access for reasons like finances or language gaps affecting travel to China. Thank you, Frederick. Short answer, it depends. Online resources are good for acquiring basic knowledge of Taoism, but a teacher is a must if you want personal guidance. It is just like practicing any other skills. Even to go down the self-taught path, you need to be aware of some basics. Even if you are able to travel to China, you have to be very careful about the language issues. Unless your teacher in China speaks your language or you speak Chinese, what you will get from the trip is just a nice trip. His second question, I quote, "When learning Chinese with regards to Daoist literature, is it more preferable to learn simplified or traditional Hanzi?" End quote. Well, in China, most educated people can write simplified characters and can read traditional Hanzi. Unless there are some special documents, most of the Daoist documents are usually found in simplified characters. My recommendation would be to start with the simplified Hanzi, and once you are comfortable with it, and if you have the time and the energy, progress to traditional Hanzi. Or else, it will consume too much of your time with no assurance of success. In the process of learning, if you are unfamiliar with both the knowledge as well as the medium, you should spend as little time as possible on familiarizing yourself with the medium and dedicate maximum time to acquiring the knowledge. Frederick, I hope I have answered your questions. Let's move on to the next one. Unknown 963 asks, quote, "Would you explain why you shouldn't practice without understanding what are the possible unwanted risks that could occur and does not include meditation as a whole or just specific Daoism practices?" End quote. Thank you, Unknown 963. Short answer, it depends on your objectives. Let me explain. Any serious practice should follow a serious training procedure. Simply practicing without the right guidance and without understanding how to manage the energetic experiences in Daoist practice can only take your practice so far. However, if you follow the basic Daoist practice principle of being natural without forcing yourself in any energetic practice, then you will not have any issues in practice. But if you force yourself too much in terms of handling different energetic experiences, then and only then some problems such as unwanted energetic experiences may potentially occur. That is what I meant by the unwanted risks. I only can talk about Daoist meditation, not other styles of meditation, since technically speaking, Xiu Dao practice has the most profound energetic experience, which requires a deeper understanding of the practice. I hope I have answered your question, Unknown 963. Now, let's look at the final question for today. Stephen Ambrosik asked a very good question about the 9 years described in some Xiu Dao books such as Da Cheng Jie Yao. He asks, quote, "Did that work actually take 9 years or does it represent the completion of the cyclical and spiralic growth as the return to the Wu Ji?" End quote. Since your comments was very long, I hope I have fully understood your question. So, my answer is based on my understanding of your text. Yes, 9 years used in any Xiu Dao document is actually only a symbolic expression for the long duration of a practice. It does not mean exactly 9 years of time at all. So, it is wrong to divide practice into three levels, which each level contains 3 years of practice, and so on. Different stages of Xiu Dao practice overlap each other, and clear-cut differentiation between stages violates the Daoist principle. Speaking of Damo's practice, I don't think it can be considered Da Dan or Great Elixir, since Da Dan is the term used only in Daoist practice, not in Buddhism practice. To my knowledge, Dharma practiced Buddhism in Shaolin Temple, not Taoism. Furthermore, there is no clear record of what Dharma practiced in front of that stone. Meditating in front of the big stone is not a Da Dan practice as in Xiu Dao. In my opinion, it is not correct to analyze Buddhist practice using Taoist terms. At the very least, we need clear and specified information on Dharma's practice before we can analyze it in a Taoist context. I hope that answers your question, Stephen. With that, we conclude this month's Q&A. Thank you all for your questions, and I hope you all found my answers informative. Also, apologize to all those whose names I may have butchered throughout this video. As always, please do not hesitate to ask follow-up questions or entirely new questions altogether. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.